Joe, of course, we've got to talk about legendary Manchester boxing trainer Phil Martin. We're celebrating his 25th anniversary of his death and commemorating him. Can you just tell us a little bit about your history with Phil Martin? I know you have a real connection with Phil Martin.
Yeah, 25 years. I remember the first time I went to Champs Camp, and just before then we used to drive past in the amateur club that I used to be at, and we used to drive Princess Parkway, and we used to see this picture on the wall of Hagler and Duran outside the gymnasium, and who we were with at the time. It was called Champs Camp, they were going to Tramps Camp, and I remember being at the College of Building in Manchester, and everyone was talking about Moss Side ABC and the amateurs, and they were doing well and everything else. So I decided to, I turned senior then to brave it, and I'm saying, oh, you don't want to go there, don't want to go there. And it isn't racial, but a lot of people say there's no whites in that gym, you don't want to go there. But it's like, nah, I wanted to. I seen what they were doing, fighters like Tony Acubia, not much experience, Ozzy Maddox going to the championships and doing well, and there was a real buzz around the gymnasium. And I remember walking up the big red steps up one Sunday morning, getting the 105 from Benchill within short of Moss Side, and then Phil was there training at a lad skipping, and it was just his presence. You're at the top of the stairs and you're seeing him, you're like, oh, you know. Phil goes, yeah, and you go, yeah. At this time I'd had 40 odd amateur fights, but within a split second I felt like a kid that hadn't had a fight, and I was just saying, yeah, trying to, that's half big, that was half good, sort of like saying, yeah, I box at Withinshaw and I've had around 40 odd fights and done this, done that, and I just wouldn't mind whether it would be all right to join you. And Phil says, oh, right, okay, so why do you want to come here? He said to me, I was like, wow. I said, well, I see what you're doing at the shows, and there's a thrive, there's a buzz to it, and I want to be a part of it. So he says, okay, then. He said, gym's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, this time. If you're not here, the door's locked, and the sessions all start without you. So I went, right, yeah, no problem. So he says, right, I'll see you on Monday. So I remember going down the stairs. Now, where you come out the gym, to the left, used to be the bus station on the left-hand side, it's not down now. I remember running, giddy as hell, to Claremont Road, as though like I could jump in the air, thinking, oh my God, I was so pleased I could go. Got the bus home, and then I went on the first night, and loved it. I remember us all warming up all the time. Everyone used to warm up skipping to Michael Jackson's Don't Stop Till You Get Enough. That was the tune. And Phil had the 12-inch version, so it was like 7 or 8 minutes. But yeah, that was it. And the rest is history then. Obviously fought for Moss Side ABC. Great days, great nights. Boxed abroad with Maurice Cole, with Phil in Holland. Boxed down in Hereford with Mario Culpepper. Great fighters at the time, do you understand? At the time you had Des Robinson as well, like I say, Ozzy Maddox, Tony Acubia, John Green, Joey Jacobs, all them. It was just a great time. Paul Hampson, a good amateur fighter. And that was it. And then over time, I went away for a couple of years, came back, and Phil asked me, did I want to take charge of the amateur team, because obviously he was professional now. I'd stayed in touch with Phil when Ensley Bingham, Andy Till, seeing all the lads going on, and he gave me my break. 1993, hence Gallagher's gym since 1993, to run the amateurs, and our first year we won, was it 27 out of 31, second year 40 out of 44, won a schoolboy title. Phil Hennigan got to the ABA semi-finals, that's when it included Scotland, England and Wales. Yeah, not looked back, and working there in the daytime with Phil, being in the office, being in around, studying, watching, and him just giving me an education and understanding what you're looking for and what opponents are looking for. And he was my mentor, and he at that time, and this is when we're talking 1987, 88, polar heart rate monitors, Charlton Marina, bar bags. Phil had been away, studied, and having that sport, science, even way back then, and that was it. He was ahead of his time.
You obviously look back at him with a lot of fond memories there, and you know, what do you think made him such a good trainer? Like, what do you think makes a good trainer, and in particular, your experiences with Phil?
I think Phil, a former boxer himself, been on the road, had a good win, lost, I think beat Tim Wood, lost to Bunny Johnson, other way round. Yeah, I think it was just in him, and I think at the time as well, after the riots, it was about setting up something. Phil obviously was in the union, obviously did marches, everything else. He was also very smart. He wasn't just a boxing trainer for a man, he was very smart, educationally wise, read a lot of stuff, and he was very, very smart. And he wanted to, like I say, a phoenix from the flames. He resurrected that building, that derelict building, made it, and of a nighttime print. Princess Parkway over night time in the late 80s and early 90s was dead. The only thing that everyone used to see on the buses in out of Manchester was this gymnasium with the lights on and all the windows full of sweat running down it, and it was like a lighthouse, shining beacon for the youth of that area at that time of that generation, and it took kids off the street, which was in bad times then. And from it, it was great. He had so many champions, British champions, and everything else. But the amount of success stories that didn't even box or go on to box, but instilled the work ethic, the dedication, the respect that went on to become painters and decorators, lawyers, accountants, in other fields of work, the work ethic and everything else. There's very much, it's not like copying, but it's very much like what Brendan Ingle did with Sheffield. There's all the success stories of the champions, and the same with Phil, but there's an awful lot of success stories of Phil Martin that haven't been told, a lot more than there was, do you know what I mean, with his four British champions. Carl Thompson, his European champion, who was on the cusp, just did a deal with Frank Warren to do a deal for Frank Grant, I think it was, possibly to fight Gerald McClellan. There was huge fights being made, and like you say, to have passed away at such a young age, at the age of 44. And at the time, I think I was 25. But when I became 44, you realised how young he really was, and his lovely wife, Audrey, and his children as well, Andrea, Carlos, Mario. Yeah, Phil, he was all about the fighters. He was a fighter's man, and I think that's why everyone holds him in such esteem and respect.
You know, he was known as a tremendous conditioner as well, as you've mentioned and alluded to, as well as a boxing man. You know, and so are you. You're known as getting your fighters into extremely good condition and shape. Have you implemented lots of things you learnt from Phil into your own setup that you have here at Gallagher's Gym?
Yeah, 100%. I think if you look at Manchester and the Manchester, what Phil Martin, when he passed away, what has gone on and since achieved, when you look at Oliver Harrison, Humphrey Harrison, you look at Billy Graham, you look at Joe Pennington, myself, we're all products of Phil Martin, Morris Corr, Haroon Headley. We're all products of that champs camp, and we're the seeds that he sowed, and it's bearing the fruit. So when Phil Martin says, when everyone says, oh, champs camp, they had four British champions, well, not in my world they didn't. They had 17 British champions, they had four world champions, because whatever I got were Phil's. Do you know what I mean? It was his education, his discipline, his motivation. He's not afraid to go against the grain. And in the amateurs as well, they didn't like the fact to turn up, the win, the beat, the favourites, the England kids and stuff like that. And the establishment were against him. Phil was working hard trying to get TV deals. And that was it. He stood for what was right. And if it's right, it's right. And if it's wrong, it's wrong. And I remember a promoter coming over here with fighters, and then he tried to do a runner with the money, and Phil got people in a car to go off after them. And right's right and wrong's wrong. And Phil's values and morals was just right. But at the end of the day, at the same time, he also understood his fighters needed to know how to fight, and they have to go on the road and fight. So when you look back and you see like Carl Thompson beating Nicky Piper, Frank Grant beating Harold Graham, Paul Burke beating Billy Shuer, they weren't given fights. They had to be able to fight. And when you were a Phil Martin fighter, you could fight. And that's true. And that's true for the likes of who Billy Graham, myself, and everyone else. All them lads, all our products, all our fighters, all can fight.
And do you think, you know, obviously he was a community man as well, as you've mentioned. Do you think it's important to have these community figures in today's society, it's getting even more broken, isn't it, on the streets? The youngsters need something to look to. I know you've got your Joe Gallagher's Academy as well, which does sort of a similar impact. But do you think it's important that we have those really strong community members that can guide people as well, on a, not even on a boxing level, just on a morals and values level?
Yeah, 100%. Like I said to you, it isn't just about the boxing, but them people that have come through them doors of Phil Martin that came at work, and that sense of belonging, that was the key thing at Champs Camp, that sense of belonging. You were part of the team. It was such an emerged family, work ethic team. Everyone, even if you have one or two kids fighting in Hereford, the minibus would be full going to Hereford. Whether it was at Main Road in the ABAs, everyone would be there supporting. It was that work ethic. It was very much, everyone's against us, we don't care. And we and Phil and Moss Side loved turning up, upsetting the apple cart and coming back. And that was it. And the people that didn't box, they had that same work ethic, that sense of belonging, going out there into the world. People said you couldn't get things. You can't be a painter and decorator. You can't be an accountant. What Phil installed them is, no, yes, you can. And they did, and they went on. And, yeah, there's loads of success stories. And I'm always surprised how what Phil did for the city of Manchester, for the district on Moss Side, how he was never awarded, acknowledged any OBE, MBE, CBE, anything else. And still today, it's very clear the impact what Phil Martin had in Manchester speaks why Manchester boxing was booming in the mid-2000s with Ricky Hatton, and why it is for the likes of Anthony Crawler and the Scott Quiggs and everyone else now.
And just one final sort of question about Phil. You know, when you look back, you know, when you think someone mentions Phil to you and you think back to those days, you think back to him, is there an emerging memory that comes out? Is there anything in particular that sort of you look back at and makes you sort of chuckle or makes you sort of feel reminiscent of those days?
There's a few. I speak to Phil quite a lot, and I can hear his voice. There's a presence, I hear his voice. And sometimes I go away and I think and I speak as though I'm a conversation, and I ask him for guidance and certain things. But there is things. Usually when he used to take the mickey out of Maurice Corr, because Maurice would walk in with some outlandish swagger from the weekend or some dress sense or everything else. That Mario had given him kittens, Mario Culpepper, what an exceptional talent. But Mario, he was back flipping in the gym, and Phil just look and go, Joe, just like, so it was all that. And but at the same time, I was a nice person, it was really hard and rueful. But I always remember, and it always stayed with me, and there's never been a true word said. He said, Joe, I remember being in the office one day, I think I'd just had Levi on the marina in the morning. And I came in and I said, oh, Levi, schoolboy champion boxer in England. And he started laughing, and he says, Joe, he said, listen, he said, you're going to do well at what you're going to do. He says, the work ethic's in you, he says, but what's got to happen, and I'm going to tell you now, he said, this is what happened. See that out there, and he pointed out, he had a Rover, a black Rover. He said, and see that there, he says, yeah, Champs Camp minibus, KO ring, pam, daddy on it. He says, yeah. He says, people think, because I drive a bit of a better car, we've got the minibus, they see all this, they see us on TV, and at the time there was Granada Fight Night, whatever on was at the time, you had Ozzy Maddox and that against Wally Swift, them type of fights. People's perceptions of you change. They think because you drive a nice car, or you're on the telly, they start going, look at him, who does he think he is, blah, blah, blah. He says, and that's going to happen to you, but you're going to be no different, like I'm not, in the fact that I'm first in the gym and I'm last in the gym. I'm still doing, I'm still working, everything else. And do you know what? That was never a truer word. Never, ever a truer word. People's perceptions of you change, yet you've never changed, you're still the same, but it's because of that. And that's always stuck with me. And that's always stuck with me. So, yeah, that's one story that he spoke to me, and it always stuck with me.
I think if he looked at you now and looked at what you'd accomplished with your set of fighters, he'd be very proud. You think he'd have a few things to say to you about the state of what you managed to do with the lads as well.
Yeah, I am.
And Natasha, of course.
Yeah, I remember it being 25 years. I was in New York this year. It's Phil's 25th year anniversary. Everyone knows that I bang stuff out all the time, go to the grave, flowers, the whole lot. And I was in New York, and I said to Steve Bunce, I reminded him, we were doing interviews, and I went up to Steve Bunce and went, Steve, 25 years today. He looked, and Phil passed away. Oh my, it is, isn't it? I said, yeah, 25 years. I said, and I think it was three days before it, I said, and on Saturday, one of his prodigies was walking out in Madison Square Garden as a trainer and a manager of the world number one at 168. I know Phil's looking up there, going down, going, you've done well. That's all I needed to know. And in the arena, I thought about it. When I got in the ring, had a moment to myself. I hope you're proud of what we've done here. And had a little moment in the ring talking to Phil. So,
yeah. And I'm sure he would have been proud. And yeah. Joe, I really appreciate you telling us some of those memories. And thanks very much for your time.
Cheers, no problem. Thank you.